Thank you for coming. So this is my talk about the new sculpting workflow in Blender. I'm Pablo Dobarro. You probably know me for posting features, videos of Blender features on Twitter. But the important thing you need to know about me is that I love to make art and I hate computers and everything that has to do with them. But they let us do amazing things, so we have to deal with it. I studied computer science and I ended working as a system administrator. And I ended up so psychologically traumatized that I started to sculpt cute K-pop girls, and this is way much fulfilling for my life. So I started like designing better tools for doing this, basically. My idea for this presentation was to, I spent working like crazy like these past 2 weeks to have 2.82 sculpt mode ready to show you it here for the first time. But basically, almost all prototypes are working for 2.82, and the most important patches are ready for review. And I'm going to show you a little bit about that at the end of the presentation. But the important thing is that we don't have any 2.81 documentation about the sculpt mode. And basically, right now, the official documentation for Blender is the donut. And we don't have proper videos on YouTube on how to sculpt a donut with the new sculpting tools. So this talk is primarily focused for artists. And then I'm going to explain you how you can use these tools and how they actually work at the code level. So this talk is going to have code, sorry. And it's going to have way more information that you will ever need to use these tools. But it's important that you know how do they exactly work. So if you want to make tutorial videos or share this knowledge, you are sharing true information and not confusing people even more on how this tool works. And yeah, it had my not aligned tech boxes, so sorry. Okay, this is the voxel remeasure. That is one of the main features of 2.81. That basically lets you break geometry as hard as you want with modifiers, with bugs in the sculpt brushes, and it will fix everything just magic pressing a button. So, this is the voxel remeasure. It has 58 lines. So let's go line by line explaining how does it exactly work. And I'm not joking. I'm going to go line by line of all the features. First, get the active object and stop the operation if the voxel size is 0, because computers don't like zero in input fields with numbers because they crash. Then we store the geometry of the current object in the sculpting undo system. This is new in 2.81, and this will let us have sculpt operations which modify the mesh in a single step, like trimming tools, edit mesh brushes, insert brushes, and all those kind of things. And after that, this is the whole voxel remesh, basically. And if we click on that function and go inside that function, we're going to find OpenBDB things. And basically, the voxel remesher is just those two functions, that is converting the mesh to a level set and converting the level set again to a mesh. If we keep clicking in those functions, those are two OpenBDB functions without anything else. So let's go and explain what this function does with an extreme simplification that will make every OpenBDB developer cry, but whatever. let's suppose we have this line, and we put a grid on top of the line. Then we put zeros in the cells that are closer to the line. Then we fill with ones to one side and one minus one to another side. Then we choose, then we read, and this is a level set, basically. So then we are going to convert that grid of numbers back to a mesh. So we have this, and we draw a line between the ones and the zeros. And this line is something similar to the original line. Now you do this with 3D math, and you have a pre-measure. And this is what OpenBDB is doing. Then the next step the voxel remeasure does is fixing the poles. That is a really complex algorithm that you are going to see right now. Basically, where this is doing like enter edit mesh, that is creating vMesh, but you can think of it like enter edit mesh. And then we are going to do something across all the faces of the model. So we are going to check face by face. If there are two vertices that has three edges connected that are opposite in the quad. So this quad has 4 and 5, it's not valid. Then it has 4 and 3, it's not valid. The next quad has 5 and 5, so it's valid. And 3 and 3, so it's valid. Yeah, this quad is valid. So we are going to remove it and create an edge between those vertices. And we keep doing this for the whole mesh. This quad now has 5 and 3, so it's not valid, but before it was valid. Then we do this for all the meshes, for all the quads in the mesh, and then collapse the edges. And basically, you have your topology fixed. Then we also check for quads that have three connected edges in all of these vertices. And that has, we remove it, and we run the fill holes operator. And then we select everything, and we smooth the mesh, and you're done. This is what this option does. And this was an idea of Julian Kaspar, so I just implemented it. Then there is an option in the voxel remeasure that's called preserve volume, and that's literally apply a syngrap to the original mesh. And if you look at the code, you look that it's a syngrap modifier, and it's exact same code as a syngrap modifier, and those are the options of the syngrap modifier. So if you look, if you go to the Blender code and change these options, you maybe could find a better defaults that produce less artifacts, because if you try the voxel remeasure, you know that something it goes crazy and projects vertices to the other side of the object. But it's basically tweaking these values. And then we have the reproject mask flag that runs this complex reprojection code that searches for the nearest vertex in the original mesh and copies its mask value for the new mesh. And this is the final lines on the voxel remeasure. And it's basically copying the data to the original data block and smooth the normals and store the mesh on the sculpting undo system to be able to redo to the operation again without running the remeasure again. And that's it. That's the whole voxel remeasure. So now that we know how it works, probably a user is going to download 2.81 and is going to run the voxel remeasure on the default cube and is going to get this, and the reaction is going to be this. But the user is going to rotate the cube and is going to get this, and then the user is going to do this. But now we know that in the first case scenario, it works because the faces of the cube are aligned to the internal grids we are evaluating the volume. So it will look like this internally. So when you are recreating the mesh, it will recreate quads perfectly aligned to the faces because the grid was aligned to the faces of the cube. As soon as you rotate the cube, you are going to get this, and there's no possible fix for this. So this is the most important thing to know about the voxel remeasure. It is not a retopology tool, and it won't ever be a retopology tool. So what is the voxel remeasure for? It is good for sculpting because it fixes self-intersections and geometry errors and all those kinds of things. It is also good for creating meshes for 3D printing for the same reasons. You can export a mesh out of the voxel remeasure and you can send it to a slicer and it is going to work just fine. And it is also fine for creating simulation proxies because it's a mainfold mesh based of quads, and usually physics simulators don't have issues with this. What you should never do with the voxel remesher is use it for retopology of any kind of objects because the edge flow is going to be completely random. And you should never, never, never subdivide a mesh from the voxel remesher. I mean, if you look at this, there's no way this is going to look fine after subdividing it. So I've seen a lot of tutorials in YouTube explaining that subdividing this will improve the result, and no. Yes, no. Next, quadriflow. Quadriflow basically does this. Come on, do something. Okay, it creates quad topology like the voxel remesher, but we are going to see that it's not the same. So quadriflow, we didn't implement the core algorithm. It's from this GitHub repository and from this paper. And the implementation in Blender is quite similar to the voxel remesher. You just switch the two OpenBDB functions we just saw from the quadriflow, and the rest is basically the same. And as you can see here, there's a bisect and a mirror operations before and after, and this is how we are faking symmetry in quadriflow. Really, symmetry should come from quadriflow itself, but this was the easy solution to get it working for 2.81. And if you are smarter than me and you know how to code a decimate algorithm to put right there to avoid filling quadriflow with a million vertices, that will definitely improve performance a lot. So this is what I just said, is the code from this checkbox in the mirror modifier that runs before quadriflow, and then it's the same code from that checkbox in the mirror modifier. So quadriflow, if you read the paper that's based on, it's basically this, you know that it mentions in several places that this is useful for creating meshes for Clark subdivisions. In this case, when sculpting, especially stylized or hard surface characters, you can sculpt with the voxel remesher and polish your surfaces with the scrape brush. But eventually you are going to have a topology like this, and you can keep sculpting and you're never going to get a perfectly clean edges. So to have those kind of edges, you need to have geometry aligned to the edges of the model. So you can polish like with the pinch brush and with the scrape, and you are going to get this that looks perfectly fine. Okay, so for high poly sculpting, edge flow is not important. So basically any quad solution should work fine because you are going to add a lot of texture detail on top of it, and that's not important. But for stylized and for hard surface, edges must be perfectly aligned to the features of the mesh. And if there's one of those edge loops that is not correct, the result is not valid because it is going to have shading artifacts in your model. And there's no automatic solution that guarantees this in all cases. So you have two options, or you do manual retopology, that is basically what most of us do, or we have a quadriflow manual guides that we are planning to add at some point. And with this, you can tell quadriflow that an edge loop must go exactly in that place. And that is the only important thing quadriflow needs to do in Blender. So basically, quadriflow is in Blender just for creating base meshes for subdivision surfaces. And it is not for remeshing the model while sculpting. This is very important, but I'm going to come to talk about this later. And obviously, it's not going to create final topology for animation ever. And it's also not useful for mesh decimation because we have much faster algorithms than this to reduce the polygons of a mesh. And it's not going to fix mesh artifacts and geometry artifacts for 3D printing. Probably it's going to create more artifacts right now. and it's not going to fix 3D and scans, in general, it's not going to work that well with high polycans as an input. So this is really important, and I think we also have this wrong in the official vendor documentation. Voxel remesh is not a faster, less precise version of Quadriflow. They are not the same, and they are not designing for the same. You saw how the voxel remesher works, and you saw how Quadriflow works. So when you are working, it's not a matter of choosing Quadriflow or the voxel remesher, depending on how much time do you want to spend between different remeshings. Okay, this is what I just said. So comparing their output doesn't make any sense at all in any cases. They are totally different things and totally different tools, even if they are in the same menu and in the same shortcut, and they should not be in the same menu and the same shortcut, but they are. Also, very important, the Quadriflow workflow is not finished in 2.81, because basically the Quadriflow, the target for Quadriflow is to have this operator. Is to have a button with one click that does these things. It needs to calculate a reasonable number of polygons for the base mesh. Then it needs to generate a new base mesh with this number of polygons with Quadriflow. Then it needs to subdivide that mesh with multi-res to get a similar vertex count to the source mesh. Then it needs to reproject the details from the previous sculpt to the multi-res version. And then it needs to reconstruct all the levels up to level zero in multi-res. This is how it should work. At some point, it's going to work like this, hopefully. Okay, so now let's talk about the sculpt mode tools in 2.81. You know that I was working on a branch called the sculpt mode features branch, and I wrote this blog post in developer.blender.org. And I was proposing three solutions in order to have those tools in 2.81 as soon as possible. And there were those three. And we end up doing this. Make an abstraction layer for the data, whatever. So I'm going to explain you how exactly this works. Imagine this is your mesh, created with vertex faces and edges. And you have to reference these points from a sculpt tool. Before 2.81, you can't reference these points in the code. You can tell the code, I want to get the mask value or the coordinates of the normals or of that point. In 2.81, we added these indices to the mesh, so we can write instructions in the tools like this, and then the sculpting system will look up for that data. In that case, is the how is the max data, and you can get those value. But also, what you can do with this is you can create another copy of that data and write another custom values that the tools are using, and associate them with the index of that vertex. And those values are what are making all the tools work. So, okay. And the other thing we did in 2.81 is to create a way to get from the index number of a vertex, get the neighbor vertices, get the indices of the neighbor vertices. And this code works both for vMesh, for multi-resolution, and for regular meshes, but we are going to talk about that later. And if you need to write code that runs in all the neighbors of that vertex, you just write those three lines and it works. And this was a slide here. Okay. This is trivial to do with regular mesh sculpting because meshes are already an array with indices, so there's no problem there. And this is why all the features in the sculpt branch were only working with meshes. And within topo, you can do this as long as you don't change the topology between inside the operation because you are going to mess up all the indices. So that's why the new operators don't work within topo updating the topology. Because and each time you start a new operator, it needs to rebuild all those indices in the mesh, so the topo is going to be a little bit slower in 2.81. And this is not that easy to do with multi-res because of how multi-res works, but I'm not going to enter on that detail. Okay, so what you need to know about the sculpting system is like we have those that function that basically gets the coordinate of a vertex given its index. And as you see, it has three different implementations. And these are three completely separate systems in which sculpt runs. And you see here that one system runs with when you're sculpting with regular meshes with modifiers, one system runs when you're sculpting within topo, and another one runs with you are sculpting with multi-res. And this happens all across sculpt mode. I mean, this is the sculpt mode rendering updates. You see it has three different functions. This is undo, it also has three different functions. And this is the brush deformation code that it also has three different functions. So this is very important. The topo is not just an option you check and it generates new geometry and that's fine. It's going to make the sculpting system run in a totally different code in all areas. So it's like entering another mode instead of just a single option. So when you are using the topo, you are running the slowest possible mode sculpt mode can run. It doesn't matter that the topo is not generating new geometry or is not updating the mesh. It's just you are running sculpt mode over vMesh. I'm going to talk a lot about that later. So the good thing about the voxel remesher is that it keeps sculpt mode inside the faces code path, which is way faster than the topo, but you can keep sculpting with dynamic topology. So even if the topo only adds detail where it's needed, it is never going to be faster than sculpting with the voxel remesher. So you should only use the topo when you need it for creating some kind of effect with a tool, like for the snake hook to create that effect or something like that, and disable it as soon as you finish. As I said, you can always get to a higher level of detail with the voxel remesher because you are using the fastest, no, not the fastest, but a faster sculpt mode version than the DynTopo one. And the DynTopo mesh representation is vMesh, that's basically the mesh representation that is using in edit mode, so that is an absolute overkill for a sculpt mode tessellation, that basically the only thing it needs to do is to keep triangles and split triangles and collapse triangles. So we can still use this for new tools like creating edit mesh brushes because we have all the base code ready. So to show you this in the code, how it actually looks, we're going to see the code for the smooth brush that basically checks the network vertices of a vertex and averages the coordinate and puts it in the middle vertex. This is how it looks for meshes. This is how it looks from the topo. As you can see, a simple algorithm as that is different from the two modes. And this is how it looks for multi-res. So if you are thinking of coding a tool like the PostBrush with dealing with this, it's never going to work. And this is how it looks in 2.81 after writing the API. As you can see, there's the neighbor iterator, and there are two functions to get the coordination of a vertex. So now that we know that that is the base for all the new sculpting tools, I'm going to show you how a simple operator works. This is mass grow operator. First, you create a copy of the max data, and then you check for that vertex what is the maximum value of the connected ones. And you put that number there, and you repeat the same for the rest of the vertices, and the mass grows. It's as simple as that. Then another one more complex one, which is max expand. You start with the selected vertex under the cursor, and from that, you put a one, and in the connected vertices, you put a two, and in the two, you check the connected vertices again, and you put a three, and you continue doing this until you fit the whole mesh. And that's why max expand creates this kind of shapes if you try it. And then if you want to expand the max from the vertex 0 to a 3, you only need to check the vertices that have a lower number or an equal number to 3. and this is how mask expand works. So the thing you need to know about mask expand is that all those numbers, all those interaction numbers are created as soon as you press Shift A. And that depends on the number of vertices the mesh has. Okay, so now we go with the pose brush. I'm going to explain you how it works. Pose brush is the... So imagine this is the sculpt cursor and the red dot is the active vertex. So like in Max Expand, well, first we are going to create like a sphere from that vertex with the radius of the brush. And like in Max Expand, we are going to expand a data value from the vertices like that until here. So there you see that there is a vertex that has one... There's a line that has one vertex inside of the sphere and one vertex outside of the sphere. So we are going to keep only those vertices that have one inside and one outside. So we end up with this ring of vertices, and then to determine the origin of the pose brush and the rotation center, you only need to average the position and you get the rotation of the pose brush. So the inverse kinematic pose brush works similar to this. But instead of starting again with the red dot, it starts from another vertex in that ring. It's something similar to that, not exactly that, but you have an idea how it works. And to solve the inverse kinematic, it is using this tutorial, basically. It's not anything super complex. I basically learned everything I know about computer science from that channel, so it's not like there are complex things in this code. Okay, so let's talk about performance. That is the most important topic in scale mode. So we know that basically all character modeling courses start with a quote that may look like this. And if you read this, you start to think that this does not make any sense. But for digital sculpting, we are used to hear this again and again and again. And when we are talking about performance in digital sculpting, usually we are talking about this, the number of vertices that can be affected by the brush. So when you say that there's a sculpting program that can handle 100 million vertices, you need to think if that program can really support a stroke that modifies 100 million vertices in one operation, and I can tell you that it won't work. So performance can also be measured like this. This is my workspace, and basically this is the specifications of my computer that you see is not that powerful, but it can move 12 viewports with different shaded modes, with two 4K monitors and two 1080p monitors and textures in the sculpt and geometry with active modifiers. So it's like this, no other program can do this in sculpt mode. So we, instead of trying to go to the, like, to try to say that we have the program that can manage and can manipulate meshes with a higher polygon count possible, we need to focus on performance issues that are relevant for the sculpting workflow, such as this. The smart brushing multi-res is unusable, and that's true. In general, the smooth brush is too slow for smoothing high-poly meshes. We also can try to make entering and exit sculpt mode real-time instead of rebuilding everything each time with switch mode, because that's our workflow issue that's not relating to brush performance. And this is basically the same. We don't need to rebuild internal data structures each time we change modes. So this is basically what I think about the performance in scale mode. that Sculpting is just a modeling workflow and sculpting extremely high polygon characters and meshes is just a use case for that workflow. And associating digital sculpting with mesh performance is just how we built a workflow around a particular tool that does this particularly well. But this does not mean that we have to be a competitor in this area to that tool, because it's going to make us lose an insane amount of time and we are going to go nowhere, basically. So for high poly sculpting, before having an amazing performance and all of this, we need to have this issue solved before that are way more important than performance, especially the first one. And about the multi-res modifier, I also want to say some things for 2.81, it is not finished and the new tools are not going to work properly with the current multi-res modifier. So for the new tools, basically the yellow ones that are meant to deform the mesh, those tools are way more performance demanding than the rest of the brushes. And that's why they are designed to deform the lowest level of multi-res modifier. I mean, you don't need to pose a character in the 10 million vertex version of it. So basically the issue with the multi-res modifier we have is that if we have this mesh and we sculpt some detail in the higher level of subdivision and then go back to the lower one to pose it with the pose brush, if we return to the highest one, we are going to have this, and there's no way to fix this with undo, with saving. If you don't have a save file before, you basically break all your work. And I think we really need to fix this as soon as possible, if possible before shipping 2.81, because a lot of users are used to this workflow and are expecting the multi-res modifier work that way. And if we don't know this, they are going to break all the sculpts. And yeah, this is what I'm talking about. If we can fix this for 2.81, I think we should probably disable multi-resolution sculpting in this release, because it's going to be bad. So let's talk about 2.82. Maybe you've seen this video, but this patch is already on review, so probably next week you're going to have it in Blender. That's Topology Relax. This is like the Relax tool that was in the Scala branch, but it's a better algorithm that this can handle millions and millions of vertices, and it should not create artifacts. Then we are going to have the new vertex paint mode, that my goal is that you are going to be able to paint at the same resolution of a 4K texture with vertex paint, with illustration level brushes, not just a brush that paints the vertex that's under it. So you will have hardness, flow, wet paint, smooths, and all those kinds of effects that typical illustration program has. This sphere has 7 million vertices, and you can see that it works fine, and this is just the first version. We can still do a lot of optimizations. Then we are going to have the new face map visibility system, where you can create groups of faces and hide them and use it to mask the tools and smooth different face maps, which is way more advanced than the current tools we have, which are limited to hide mask and hide box. I don't know if this is going to be the final name for this feature, but I have to write something in the code and name it somehow. So as you saw, all the tools that are in 2.81 are basically created just using these two things that are added in the base code. And in 2.82, these are going to be the new base things that I'm going to add to the sculpting system. With vertex color data and face indices, we're going to get the new sculpt mode and the visibility system. With ordered topology connectivity, we are going to get brushes that can create effects that flow across the topology, like for example, you are going to be able to extract parts of the mesh like dragging like this and things like that. And with geodesic distances, we are going to have things like topology follows and probably let the max expand work in a circular way instead of a square pattern. And if I have times, maybe I can try to code some based on a fixed timer events, and this means brushes with physics simulation inside of them. And this is basically it. Thank you. So, if you have any questions. Yes, sorry.
Can we also get brush management stuff in?
Brush meshes.
Brush workflow and brush.
Yeah. There's also William asked if we are going to get the brush management system in 2.82. And that's planned. I personally want to do a lot of reorganization in the code to support a better organization of brushes. So if we can solve the asset management issue about how are we going to store the brushes, and we can probably have a better brush management system in 2.82.